Thank you, sir, for that introduction and also for including me in your CME. I'll be talking on the fundamentals of the drainage implant surgeries. How did it all start? Drainage surgeries began with the development of setons, where basically these are solid structures like threads or hairs or sutures, which are placed in the wound to form a drainage channel. Then came the shunts, which are passive tubular structures, but they are incapable of influencing the direction of flow. And this was followed by the development of valves, which are designed to allow unidirectional flow. Glaucoma drainage implants are specially devised plates with tubes which connect the aqueous from the anterior chamber to a septinon's lake, which is created at the equator. So it all began in 1907 with the first use of a horsehair. This was then developed into sophisticated polythene and silicone tubes. But the major breakthrough was in 1973 when the Moulton implant was developed. This was followed by the Crouppen implant, and in 1981, Molteno developed the double plate implants. This was followed by the development of the bar weld, and finally, again a major breakthrough in 1993 when the AGVs were developed. And the rest is history. We all know how it has progressed. Currently, the most frequently used are the AGVs. We have the Indian version, that is the Keki Mehta valve. We have the Adi, that is the Aurolab aqueous drainage implant, which is a modified Indian version of the bar weld, and we have the express shunt. Now, what are the parts of these implants? Basically, whether it is a non-valved or it is a valved, there is a connecting tube which is made up of silicone, there is a reservoir plate, there are fenestrations, there are anchoring holes. The fenestrations are mainly to anchor with the fibrous tissue, and the edge of the external plate where the tube inserts, there is a ridge which decreases the chance of occlusion of that tube at that part. And in the valves in this area, there is a membrane valve made up of silicon elastomers, which open when the IOP rises more than 8 to 10 millimeters of mercury. How do these tubes act? A feature which is common to all GDDs is the construction of the plate is from such a material to which the fibroblasts cannot adhere. So as you can see, the implant is sitting on the sclera, there is a bleb cavity here, and there is a fibrous capsule here, which is the main feature for all the filtration that happens through these valves. When you implant the GDD into the episcleral space near the equator with the tube either in the AC or in the pars plana, there begins the formation of a collagenous capsule. Because this silicon plate, it attracts the plasma and the proteins, which leads to a granulomatous reaction and a capsule formation. So this capsule is surrounded by a granulomatous reaction. This reaction resolves within 4 months, and the capsule gradually becomes firm and stabilized, and this then matures over time and gets thinner by 6 months. What happens to the aqueous flow? The aqueous pools in the potential space which is formed between the plate and the capsule. It passes through the capsule by passive diffusion. And this capsule is a major structure which offers a resistance to aqueous flow and controls the IOP. And it is gradually absorbed by the periocular capillaries and lymphatics, leading to reduction of IOP. Now, after implantation of the implant, there can be various phases of changes in the IOP. There can be a hypotensive phase from day 1 to 3-4 weeks, wherein there is a diffuse thick wall bleb with minimally engorged vessels and the IOP is reasonably low. There can be a hypertensive phase, which is more common with the non-valved because the tube is ligated, and if you have not made the vents, then this is very common. It is also common with the AGVs because the aqueous starts flowing immediately and there is an immediate granulomatous and capsular reaction. It can occur 3 to 6 weeks to 4 to 6 months. There is an inflamed dome-shaped bleb because of the intense reaction, and there is increased IOP in the patient. And after these phases are over, there follows a stable phase when the IOP gets gradually stabilized. The long-term IOP control with these tubes depends upon the surface area of the implant, which is directly proportional to the outflow and inversely proportional to the bleb diameter and the bleb thickness. And as I mentioned, the encapsulation that happens, it limits the filtration life, and it is a major factor which controls the IOP. This bleb is much away from the anterior limbus compared to the other trabeculectomy and other surgical blebs. So there is reduced inflammation and reduced chances of thinning of the bleb. When do you use any of these GDDs? Complicated and refractory glaucomas, either as primary surgery, when you are almost sure that your trab with or without an antimetabolite is going to fail, or as a secondary procedure when the trab has already failed. So these cases are mainly pediatric glaucoma, neovascular cases, uveitic glaucoma, ophakic and pseudophakic glaucomas, post-VR surgery, post-PK, traumatic glaucomas, aniridia, epithelial downgrowth, and Sturge-Weber syndrome. These can also be attempted in patients with severe dry eye disease who might not tolerate the anterior trab blebs and possibly may have bleb dysesthesia, patients who wish to continue wearing contact lens postoperatively or by patient preference. When should you avoid using such a drainage implant? There are no known absolute contraindications, but technically when the eyes have severe scleral or scleral dimbal thickening, or the conjunctiva is extremely fibrosed and friable when you're not able to dissect, then you may avoid these and go for other alternatives, or in ciliary block glaucoma when the basic pathology is totally different. Where should you implant? With the exception of the two plate implants, most of these are implanted only in a single quadrant, and the one which is preferred is the superotemporal quadrant because it provides easiest access to the implant and it is least likely to produce motility disturbances. In the supranasal, obviously because there is less space, motility disturbances are common, and because of the proximity of the optic nerve, there is a risk of nerve impingement. Infranasal, again, technically very difficult. Infratemporal can be tried. It is easy. There is more space. But here, cosmetically, if you implant a scleral graft, it may not be very appealing to the patient. So in these cases, you might go for a corneal graft to cover your tube. And if there is presence of silicone oil in the eye, especially if there is an inverse hypopyon, you may place the tube in the inferior quadrant because you do not want the oil to flow through the tube. Pars plana insertion of the implant in eyes that have undergone vitrectomy, in presence of compromised corneal endothelium or grafts, when you don't want the tube to touch the endothelium and damage the graft, and in cases when there is hardly any space in the anterior chamber, as in extensive synechias. And the most important question, which implant should I use? The questions are, do all implants lower the pressure equally? Are larger ones better? Does the design influence, and does the indication differ? There is inadequate evidence to suggest that one shunt is better than the other. But overall, bigger the implant plate, more is the IOP lowering, but simultaneously greater is the risk of hypotony. And there may be, because of the size, there may be ocular motility problems. Propylene plates, they are more inflammatory than silicon. AGVs, because they are valved, they start functioning immediately and they provide improved early control. But again, because there is early encapsulation, long-term control is not as good. So barbell types, the other types, they provide a better long-term control. And because it starts functioning a little late, these non-valve devices sometimes may need to have the glaucoma medications continued. So this added cost of glaucoma medications in the immediate post-op period may be of concern. So valve devices, the surgery is simple, the IOP control is earlier and predictable. It can be tried for beginners when you don't need to isolate the muscles, and surgically it is easier. In eyes that need IOP quickly, quick lowering of the IOP, in patients with poor compliance, and when you want to avoid the risk of hypotony, as in cases of high-risk cases of suprachoroidal hemorrhage. So to conclude, there is no evidence that one device out of all these is better than another. Modifications in technique are continuously happening, and modifications in design are also happening, which lead to improved clinical outcomes and fewer complications. Careful pre-op screening, proper planning, and a meticulous surgery is essential, and selecting a device should be individualized. You have to see the profile of the device, your own experience, and what treatment goals you have, the patient's age, their economic status, and the overall clinical situation.